لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله، لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله، لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله، لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه وبعد. Honorable Ulama, beloved brothers, this month of Ramadan, we all know that two-thirds of this month has passed. If you would like to bring back the first day of Ramadan, it will never come back. If you would like to bring back the first week of Ramadan, it is impossible. If you would like to bring back last Ramadan or the previous Ramadan that went by, it is totally impossible. We all understand this. What we should learn from this is the remainder of this month, we need to use it in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to gain something. Let us understand one thing. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of the criminals in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that they are the ones whom when death comes to them, they will say, Oh Allah, send us back to the dunya, now we want to do good. That is similar to the one who has wasted his Ramadan, and he wants Allah to return day one back, so that he can now go back and do good during this month of Ramadan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of the criminals, and he says, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتُ قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونِ لعلي أعمل صالحا فيما تركت كلا. Allah says, when death comes to one of them, they will say, Oh Allah, send us back. We now want to do good, obviously, because we have seen what it is all about. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, never. Wallahi, we as Muslims have something to learn from this verse. And there are many similar verses in the Quran. What we have to learn is, wallahi, whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you an opportunity, seize that opportunity, subhanallah. In the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he makes mention of many opportunities that are given to mankind. And he makes mention of the opportunity of good health. And he says, اغتنم خمسا قبل خمس. Seize five opportunities before they are overtaken by five other conditions and situations, subhanallah. Seize the opportunity of your good health before you are taken ill. So when we are in good shape and good health, don't forget that it is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Use it in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, lest there come a day when you are sick and you will not be able to fulfill what you should have been fulfilling, subhanallah. Let me give you good news of what we have been informed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, a person who is regular with a deed, a person who is regular with a deed, say for example, Salatul Tahajjud, or a sunnah or nafil fast, so regularly, they are regular with that deed. The day they are taken ill, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the reward is already written, subhanallah. Say a person comes for salah to the masjid and he reads salah in the first saf, mashallah. One day for some reason he is taken ill, he cannot come to the masjid, the angels stick his name as though he was already there. Because he seized the opportunity when he was healthy to do good. Allah says, when you are sick, don't worry, we will seize the opportunity to give you that reward. Free reward. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. And this is why when we are healthy, take a look at your bodies and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, we are still in order. Ya Allah, you have still granted us this. We will do whatever we can, inshallah. And then the day you are ill, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you in return. Wallahi, it is in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A person who is fasting, say for example the 13th, 14th, 15th of every month, the sunnah fast. One month he is taken ill, so ill that he cannot fast. His name is ticked to be from amongst those who have fasted, though he hasn't fasted. I tell you why. Reward is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he is to reward you for a deed, is it subtracting anything from his kingdom? Is it affecting him adversely in any way? It doesn't. So what he does, he wants goodness for you. He knows, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. Your deeds will be rewarded and judged according to the underlying intentions. And this is why it is very important for us to always clarify, rectify the intentions that we have behind our deeds.
When you do something, do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to utilize this health of ours and the healthy days of ours in a manner that when we are ill, we will not regret, subhanallah. And the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continues, seize the opportunity of your wealthy days before poverty overtakes you. We all know that Allah has granted us a little bit, mashallah. That is why we are clothed here. Everyone has to a different degree and to a different level. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided. What have you done with your wealth, subhanallah? I earn, for example, 500 rands a month. Did I give out 1 rand for the sake of Allah? If I did, alhamdulillah, it is good. With the correct intention. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not worried about the quantity. He is worried about the quality. Obviously, when it comes to farad, that, yes, we should make sure the quality and quantity is right. But when it comes to nafil and sunnah, remember, if you are going to engage in quantity with no quality, no concentration, with the wrong intentions, there is no benefit of that deed, subhanallah. You are engaging in a sunnah deed to show people, a'udhu billah, you will not be rewarded for that. You might even be getting a sin in the process. This is why we are taught, rectify those intentions of yours and Allah will reward you. And remember one thing, no matter how much you earn, even if you are someone who is liable to take zakah, from your love for giving, give out 1 rand, 2 rand, 5 rands at least in the path of Allah to someone who needs, subhanallah. And you will find Allah's assistance coming to you. If you deposit 5 rands in the bank of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will see it multiplying. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ حَبَّةٍ أَنْبَتَتْ سَبْعَ سَنَابِلٍ في كل سنبلة 100 حبة والله يضاعف لمن يشاء.
The example of the person who spends his wealth in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like the example of a little seed that grows into 7 different corns. Each corn has 100 of the little 100 of the little extra seeds that grow on it, subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala multiply our reward. So, this verse shows that your good deed is multiplied 700 times and Allah did not stop there. You know what He said immediately after that?
وَاللَّهُ يُضَاعِفُ لِمَن يَشَاءُ.
It is Allah who will still multiply it further for whomsoever He wishes. Let me tell you something. To spend, yes, it is rewarding. To spend in the month of Ramadan is even more rewarding. To spend in the month of Ramadan on a Friday is even more rewarding. To spend in the month of Ramadan on a Friday that is within the last 10 days of Ramadan is even more rewarding. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. Look at the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He looks at our intention and He will grant us a reward through our intentions, and He makes mention of the fact that one day you are rich, tomorrow you will be poor. One day you are poor, tomorrow I will give you to see, to test you. We all know this world is a test. Everything that happens to us is a test. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us in order to test us. That is the creation, subhanallah. This is why the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, الدُّنْيَا خُلِقَتْ لَكُمْ. The dunya has been created for you as a place of test, subhanallah. وَأَنْتُمْ خُلِقْتُمْ لِلْآخِرَةِ. As for you, you have been created for the akhirah. You will live here and you will be tested, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will write next to your name after every test, pass or fail. If you've passed, with what colors have you passed? And if you failed, how hopelessly have you failed? That is what will be written next to your name for every single test. And I always give the example, and I'm going to say it because it's practical. The food at your house one day has to be burnt. It has to be burnt. Or one day the salt has to be a little bit too much. The reason is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala needs to write next to your name that this person, we tested him with burnt food and he passed the test. This person, we tested him with too much salt and he passed the test. He went into the house and he didn't make a big issue about it. He said, look, we all make mistakes. I won't be able to eat this. You also don't eat it. Let us, you know, cook some eggs today and we'll have that inshallah. Those eggs will take you to Jannah, wallahi. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written next to your name, this person has passed. Unlike the other unfortunate person, the food is burnt from the moment he is parking his car. He can smell it and says, what has happened today? What is it? And swear words begin to fly. Whom are you swearing? The one whom you are supposed to be the closest to, your own wife, your own daughter, someone who has cooked the food. Subhanallah. Do you think you've passed the test? Allah is watching you. It was Allah who decided the food will be burnt, not your wife or your daughter. And Allah just decided it will be burnt because He wanted to give you an opportunity to become closer to Him. What you did in the process is, you went even further away from Him. This is one thing we need to understand. Similarly, and I always mention it, you've got a car, one day it has to be scratched. And I'm sure every single one of us, if you've ever had a car, a new car that you've brought or bought, it has to be scratched because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to write your name, wants to write next to your name, this person, we tested him with a scratch regarding the dawlat of this dunya and he passed it. Regarding the wealth of this dunya and he passed the test. The scratch happened and he said, subhanallah, this is something, we are not going to park our car in the graves with us and say, Ya Allah, I've come, me and my Mercedes Benz, the two of us. A'udhu billah. That's not how it works. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to test you. This is your vehicle, you are going to leave it behind when it has one scratch. How are you affected so much? What about when you miss one rakat of salah? Which is, you are supposed to be more affected by that. That doesn't tickle you, isn't it? Allahu Akbar. Look at how we've become today. This is the month of Ramadan. We need to think of our priorities here. We need to really ponder over, what type of people are we? Are we worried about the dunya more than deen? If that is the case, where are we heading? It reminds me of, subhanallah, it reminds me of the person in India who was traveling to Bombay, subhanallah. He was traveling to Bombay. And he was standing on the wrong side of the station. So when he jumped into the train, that train was going to Delhi, not to Bombay. And he was so oblivious that when he jumped in, the two-tier system where they have a sleeper at the bottom and the top, he went to sleep at the top and he went to fall off to sleep, not realizing this train is heading in the wrong direction. When he got up, he asked, where are we? When they told him, from the bottom, they told him, you know what, we are in this area. And he thought to himself, you know what, I'm going in the wrong direction here, man. But he answered and he said, you know what, subhanallah, look at the technology. The bottom half of the train is going somewhere and the top half is going the other way. This is how we are. We have treated the dunya like this. We have become so oblivious. We are on the wrong side of the station, wallah. We are standing, heading towards the dunya. We are heading towards the akhirah in reality. Our train is going towards death and we are worried about life, subhanallah. Our train is heading towards the akhirah and we are, subhanallah, worried about this dunya so much. That one day, the day will come when we will ask, where are we? And then we don't want to say, subhanallah, this train is so advanced. The top half is going somewhere, the bottom half is going somewhere else. We don't want to be caught in that. So let us be on the right side of the station and catch the right train. We are all heading in one direction. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to understand this. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continues to say, you should seize your free time before you are occupied. What does this mean? Many of us have free time. Sometimes the weekend is free. Sometimes, obviously, as soon as we knock off from work, those of us who are working, 5 o'clock, 4 o'clock, what have you, we are free. What do you do with that time? It is being recorded, subhanallah. You know, when you have a vehicle, you have an odometer, which clocks the mileage. Is that not correct? Wherever you go, that thing keeps on moving. It is taking record of your distance, and now with the latest vehicles, even your speed, and even the fuel consumption. Everything is recorded, subhanallah. Remember one thing, when it comes to your free time also, the angels are recording everything. Take a look at your odometer. You must not be over the limits at any time, subhanallah. Your own odometer, you might not be able to see it electronically. But if you think about it, muraqabah, muhasabah, on a daily basis, the ulama of tasawuf have taught this to us. Sit in a secluded place. Think of what you've been doing through the day, wallahi. Spend 5 minutes of your free time. Ya Allah, this is what I did today. I seek your forgiveness for this. Ya Allah, this is what I did not do. Grant me the ability to do it, Ya Allah. I greeted 15 of my fellow brothers with a smile on the face and I asked them how they were. Ya Allah, reward me for that. Tomorrow, grant me the ability to greet 20 of them, subhanallah. That is now doing business with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هَلْ أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَىٰ تِجَارَةٍ تُنْجِيكُمْ مِنْ عَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. Should I show you a business that will save you from severe punishment? تؤمنون بالله ورسوله. To believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. وتجاهدون في سبيل الله بأموالكم وأنفسكم. To struggle to uplift this deen in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with your wealth and with yourselves. What is the meaning of this? We need to become conscious of what we are doing. Is what we are doing according to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not? This is the question. When we come out in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for 3 days, for 40 days, for 10 days, what are we meant to be achieving? Wallahi, we are meant to be achieving the closeness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we don't achieve the closeness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have wasted our time. We are meant to be thinking on a daily basis when we are out in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What am I? What type of a person am I? And what type of a person am I supposed to be? And what should I do to rectify the bad that I have in me? And what should I do to bring in good qualities in me, subhanallah? This is our jihad. This is our fight, subhanallah. We need to be like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was sworn, he was made to bleed, but still he made a dua. The angels came to him and said, just command us, we will crush these people. And he said, Allahumma ahdi qawmi fa innahum la ya'lamun. Oh Allah, guide my people, they don't even know what status I am of, subhanallah. And he made a dua. Allahumma inni ashku ilayka dha'fa quwwati. Oh Allah, I complain to you regarding my own weakness, subhanallah. What weakness is he complaining of? Was he weak? Wallahi, he was the strongest of the strong. It is reported in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that the Prophet of Allah miraculously was granted the strength of more than 30 men, subhanallah. He could ride a horse without a saddle. Allahu Akbar, no one could do that. He jumped onto a horse without a saddle and he arrived at Bani Qurayza before everyone else, subhanallah. This was the power of the man who was complaining how weak he was. Today, have we ever complained to Allah, Ya Allah, we are weak. Ya Allah, grant us the strength, grant us the ability to be like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or even like one of his companions. Wallahi, we have been kept away from being the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this dunya for reasons best known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us in hadith Qudsi that I looked at all the souls, I found the best, so I kept it Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I looked at the souls again and I found the best and I kept them the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This means those who were there, wallahi they were chosen to be there. The 313 who took part in the battle of Badr, wallahi they are min ahlil jannah. They were given good news of jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, اِعْمَلُوا مَا شِئْتُمْ فَإِنِّي قَدْ غَفَرْتُ لَكُمْ. Do what you want from this day on, I have forgiven you, subhanallah. If we were told that, what would go through our minds? Maybe that is why we were not chosen to be from amongst those. They were fighting for the ranks of Jannah, subhanallah. They knew they were there, but they wanted now the highest ranks, subhanallah. When with us, when it comes to the dunya, someone says you've won a car of your choice, you will start thinking of the highest car. I want the Mercedes, so whatever, E320 or what have you, the latest, subhanallah. When it comes to the dunya, why can we not think in the similar lines when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do good, I will multiply it. How much ever you so wish, depending on your intention, subhanallah, why don't we then do the best of deeds? Because we have become so hypocritical in our deeds. This is the month of Ramadan when we need to rectify that. Allah gives us the opportunity every year, but who knows, we might not see next year. Wallahi, we might not see the end of Ramadan. Yesterday a brother came to me after Salatul Taraweeh. He said, do you know, and he has been reading Taraweeh with us on a daily basis, do you know that I lost my father, subhanallah? We spoke about death. Do you know that I lost my father? Wallahi, may Allah grant us the ability to prepare for death. We must not be caught offside. You know, in football we understand what is offside. When it comes to deen, we don't understand what is offside. Allahu Akbar. You are over and above and beyond where you are supposed to be. The referee will blow a whistle. Wallahi, if you are beyond where you are supposed to be in terms of deen, and the referee blows a whistle and you die, wallahi, we don't want that to happen to us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to comprehend the similarity that I have put here in front of you. So remember, utilize your spare time, your free time in the dhikr of Allah. Remember, to spend an hour with your family is also an ibadah. To spend an hour with your family within the limits of the sharia is an act of worship. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to be good to our wives and those who are at home. They need to spend time with you. If you don't spend time with them, whom do you want them to spend time with? The neighbors. A'udhu billah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to be the best to our own families. The hadith says, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ وَأَنَا خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. The best of you are those who are best to their family members, and I am the best to my family members, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us. What do we want? Look at the example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wallahi, if you study his life with Aisha radiallahu anha, you will come to understand that this Aisha radiallahu anha, the way she lived with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the way he lived with her was amazing. Let me mention one or two points and I'm sure a lot of us will become red. She was known as Humaira because she used to blush a lot. The one who had red cheeks. You know what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do? Subhanallah. Do you want to learn how to live with your wives? Take a look at how he lived with Aisha radiallahu anha. When she ate, he used to look at the bone and the chunk that she used to eat. with the corner of his eye, and he used to smile at her, and she used to be watching him. Think of how romantic this is, subhanallah. What happens? As she is biting it, he's watching her, and he's smiling at her. As she puts it down, while she is watching, he is watching with the corner of his eye, he picks it up and smiles, and hunts for the same place where she has bitten, and bites from the same place, looking at her, smiling, making her blush, subhanallah. Can there be anyone who has taught us greater love than this? Greater affection than this, subhanallah. When she drank from the qirba, when she drank from the cups of that time, he would look for the spot where her lips were, and he would actually pick it up, hunt for that, make sure that she noticed it, and he would drink from that spot, subhanallah. That was his relation. How many of us have done that in our homes? A'udhu billah. I don't wish to say this, but sometimes we may do it with those whom it is haram to do it with. A'udhu billah. It is the month of Ramadan. Let us go home and practice the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Obviously, not now. We are fasting. After we open our fast, inshallah. And remember, to do a sunnah in the month of Ramadan, you will get the reward of a farad. Don't we know this, subhanallah? Seize your free time to engage in the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The only way you are going to engage in it is by learning it firstly. May Allah grant us the opportunity to learn the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continues, and he says, seize the opportunity of your youth before old age overtakes you. When you are young, you are bubbling and bursting with energy, mashallah, tabarakallah. Use that energy in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are at school, you are at university. Create an Islamic environment. Pick out the other Muslims. Do some sort of activity that will grant you the ability to use your time correctly. And to use that age of yours. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks of the youth. He says, وَشَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. That youth who spent his time of the period of his youth in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will grant him the shade of his arsh on the day of Qiyamah. May Allah grant that to us. And the hadith continues to say, seize the opportunity of your life before you die. Seize the opportunity of your life before you die. Do you know how beautiful is this hadith? Do you know how beautiful is this hadith, subhanallah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us opportunity after opportunity. Let me tell you how it is. When he says, seize the opportunity of your health, some people might have already lost their health. Seize the opportunity of your youth, some people might already be old. So their hearts will feel, you know what have I done? Seize the opportunity of your wealth, some people might already be poor. Seize the opportunity of your free time, some people might already be occupied. So he has ended by saying, seize the opportunity of your life. The fact that you are alive is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before you die. None of us are dead here. Otherwise we wouldn't be here. But who knows, someone may die here and now in the masjid. If it is better for us, may Allah take us away now, subhanallah. Wallahi, that is a dua that must be on our tongues. As I said, and I always say, we need to be concerned about death, but not scared to the degree that we become depressed. When you are aging, start preparing to meet Allah and be happy with that. And Allah subhanallah will look at you with the eyes of mercy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to us. Don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the greatest. Prepare for his meeting. Everyone before you has already met him. All those who are gone have already gone into the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we say met him, we are not speaking about having seen him. We are speaking about gone into his mercy. Subhanallah. So let us also prepare for it. So we should not become depressed when it comes to death. But wallahi, we can prepare for it. It is the month of Ramadan. What greater month can we have to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The question I wish to ask, if you haven't turned to Allah in this month of mercy, when are you going to turn to Allah? If you haven't turned to Allah in these last 10 days, when are you going to turn to Allah? If you haven't agreed and you haven't resolved to leave the bad you are doing, when are you going to resolve that? Who are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? The Malikul Maut to come. If the Malikul Maut comes, remember, we don't want to be from amongst the criminals whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described in the Quran. That when they see the Malikul Maut, they say, no, let us spend more time. Now we have seen, now we have yaqeen. Wallahi, my dear listeners, let us turn for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the month of Ramadan. This is the month of goodness. This is the month of khairat. It will be leaving us in a few days. It is a visitor that is going to depart very, very soon, and we will miss this dear visitor. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us truly the opportunity to seize this month of Ramadan and to use it in such a manner that we come out of it spiritually elevated, and we really are spiritually elevated. The month of Ramadan needs to make a difference It needs to make a difference for the rest of the year for us until we meet either Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during the next year or we meet the next Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all acceptance. And we ask a little request from myself. Remember, make dua for myself as well as yourselves. It is the month of dua. Don't be stingy when it comes to dua. Whatever you are doing, make dua, ya Allah. Grant me happiness, grant me good health, ya Allah. Ya, and don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Every dua you make, Allah will write next to your name goodness, because dua is ibadah itself. الدعاء هو العبادة in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To call out to Allah, you are already confirming that He is the one who can solve your problems. That is already confirming His greatness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to make dua and to engage in istighfar. Ya Allah, forgive us our sins. Ya Allah, we are sinners, ya Allah. In this month of Ramadan, grant us the ability to turn to you, ya Allah. Grant us the ability to make resolutions that will be of benefit to us. Jazakumullah khair wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka. To be late.
Alhamdulillah الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله وأعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له الحمد لله الذي خص بالفضل والتشريف بعض مخلوقاته وأودع فيها من عجائب حكمه وبديع إتقانه خلق فقدر ودبر فيسر صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد فإن عمل البر لا يكون على تمامه ولا يقوم على سوقه إلا حينما يكون بمحبة صادقة ورغبة مخلصة وليكن لك أيها المسلم في أشهر الصوم عمل وإتقان وتهجد وقرآن ولقد كان من هديه عليه الصلاة والسلام الاعتكاف في رمضان وهو لزوم المسجد طاعة لله وهو يعني عكوف القلب على الله والانقطاع عن المخلوق والاشتغال بالعبادة والذكر والقرآن وابتعد عن خوارق الصوم ومفسداته وإياك أن تقع في أعراض المسلمين واحفظ لسانك وسمعك وبصرك عما حرم الله تبارك وتعالى خاصة في هذا الشهر المبارك يقول أحد الأئمة رحمهم الله ينبغي للصائم أن يتعاهد صومه من لسانه ولا يماري كانوا إذا صاموا قعدوا في المساجد وقالوا نحفظ صومنا ولا نغتاب أحدا ومن بلي بجاهل فلا يقابله بمثل سوئه يقول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الصيام جنة فإذا كان يوم صوم أحدكم فلا يرفث ولا يصخب فإن سابه أحد فليقل إني صائم رواه البخاري واجعل شهر صومك جهادا متواصلا ضد شهوات النفس وانقطاعا إلى الله تعالى بالعبادة والطاعة ومدارسة الآيات والتنزيل وقياما مخلصا بالليل فهو موسم للتوبة والإنابة فباب التوبة مفتوح وعطاء ربك ممنوح فمتى يتوب من أسرف في الخطايا وأكثر من المعاصي إن لم يتب في هذا الشهر الكريم ومتى يعود إن لم يعد في شهر الرحمة والغفران فبادر بالتوبة إلى الله واطرق بابه وأكثر من استغفاره يقول الله تبارك وتعالى وتوبوا إلى الله جميعا أيها المؤمنون لعلكم تفلحون بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بما فيه من الآيات والذكر الحكيم أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم الجليل لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين من كل ذنب وخطيئة فاستغفروه إنه جواد كريم واعلموا أن التائب من الذنب كمن لا ذنب له إن الحمد لله أحمده وأستعينه وأستهديه وأعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله، إمام المتقين ورسول رب العالمين، الذي بعث إلى الأحمر والأسود، والذي تركنا على المحجة البيضاء الصافية النقية لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك، صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن سلك طريقهم وسار على نهجهم ودعا بدعوتهم إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فاتقوا الله عباد الله، اتقوه حق تقاته، ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. واغتنموا زمن الأرباح، فأيام المواسم معدودة، وأوقات الفضائل مشهودة، وفي رمضان كنوز غالية، فلا تضيعوها باللهو واللعب وما لا فائدة فيه، فإنكم لا تدرون متى ترجعون إلى الله، وهل تدركون رمضانا آخر أو لا تدركونه. وإن اللبيب العاقل من نظر في حاله وفكر في عيوبه وأصلح نفسه قبل أن يفاجئه الموت، فينقطع عمله وينتقل إلى دار البرزخ ثم إلى دار الحساب. قال تعالى: كل نفس ذائقة الموت. واعلموا يا عباد الله أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: ما منكم من أحد إلا سيكلمه ربه ليس بينه وبينه ترجمان. ويقول صلى الله عليه وسلم: إنكم سترون ربكم كما ترون القمر ليلة البدر، فإن الكيس من دان نفسه وعمل لما بعد الموت، والعاجز من أتبع نفسه هواها وتمنى على الله الأماني. يقول عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه: حاسبوا أنفسكم قبل أن تحاسبوا، وزنوها قبل أن توزنوا. ويقول آخر: إن الدنيا دار الممر، وإن الآخرة دار المقر، فخذوا من ممركم لمقركم. ألا فصلوا وسلموا رحمكم الله على معلم البشرية الخير، النبي المصطفى والحبيب المجتبى، كما أمركم بذلك ربكم جل وعلا. فقال عز وجل: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم فصل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على عبدك ورسولك محمد أفضل الخلق وأكرم الرسل، وارض اللهم عن خلفائه الراشدين الأئمة المهديين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي، اللهم ارض عنهم وعن سائر الصحابة والتابعين، وعن الأئمة الأربعة أبي حنيفة ومالك والشافعي وأحمد، وعنا معهم بمنك وكرمك يا أكرم الأكرمين. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين، وأذل الكفر والكافرين، ودمر أعداء الدين. اللهم انصر من نصر الدين، واخذل من خذل الدين. اللهم ادفع عنا الغلا والوبا والربا والزنا والزلازل والمحن، ما ظهر منها وما بطن. اللهم تقبل منا صيامنا وقيامنا في هذا الشهر الكريم. اللهم اجعلنا من المقبولين عندك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. اللهم اجعلنا ممن وفق لقيام ليلة القدر. اللهم تقبل منا ما قدمنا، واغفر لنا خطايانا، إنك على ذلك قدير. اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين، وارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين. اللهم انصر المجاهدين في سبيلك في كل مكان. اللهم انصرهم ولا تنصر عليهم، اللهم كن لهم ولا تكن عليهم. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا، وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. ربنا تقبل منا، إنك أنت السميع العليم، وتب علينا، إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى، وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي، يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم، وادعوه يستجب لكم، واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم، ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقموا الصلاة يرحمكم الله.
اعدلوا تراصوا ولا تختلفوا فتختلف قلوبكم. It is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to ensure the heels are all in a straight line, the shoulders are touching one another's, the rows are filled, the first and then the next. In one narration he says, if you are not going to ensure this, disunity will overtake the ummah.
Allahu Akbar.
Subhanakallahumma bihamdika.
الحمد لله رب العالمين. الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين والعاديات ضبحا فالموريات قدحا فالمغيرات صبحا فأثرن به نقعا فوسطن به جمعا إن الإنسان لربه لكنود وإنه على ذلك لشهيد وإنه لحب الخير لشديد أفلا يعلم إذا بعثر ما في القبور وحصل ما في الصدور إن ربهم بهم يومئذ لخبير الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر
سبحان ربي الأعلى سبحان ربي الأعلى سبحان ربي
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين قل أعوذ برب الناس ملك الناس إله الناس من شر الوسواس الخناس الذي يوسوس في صدور الناس من الجنة والناس الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر
تحية لله والصلاة والسلام
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
استغفر الله اللهم صل على نبينا محمد وعلى آل نبينا محمد وبارك وسلم اللهم أنت السلام ومنك السلام تباركت وتعاليت يا ذا الجلال والإكرام لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير اللهم لا مانع لما أعطيت ولا معطي لما منعت ولا راد لما قضيت ولا ينفع ذا الجد منك الجد. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى. اللهم إنا نسألك الصحة والعفة والأمانة. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا، وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان، واجعلنا من الراشدين. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم، وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على عبدك ورسولك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا، من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد، ومن يعصهما فإنه لا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئا. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: النكاح من سنتي. وفي رواية: فمن رغب عن سنتي فليس مني، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. رضوان عبد الرحمن. Listen very carefully, okay? Ghulam Mustafa Musa is the wakil of Sadia. Sadia gained permission to give you in nikah in exchange for mehr to the value of 12,000 and jewelry. At the time present were Yusuf Musa and Riyad Musa. I, your uncle Abdul Rahim Khan, on behalf of Ghulam Mustafa Musa, give to you in your nikah Sadia Musa. Do you accept in your nikah? I have accepted Sadia in my nikah. Nakahtuha wa qabiltuha wa tazawwajtuha. بارك الله لكما وجمع بينكما بالخير. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. علماء الكرام and all those present here, it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you very briefly in two lines Mufti Ismail Menk of Zimbabwe. In fact, I was appointed to deliver the khutbah and the bayan today, but see Mufti Sahab present here, I felt it my duty to earnestly request Mufti Sahab to share with you a few thoughts and a few words. Mufti Sahab really needs no introduction. Many of you have heard him over the airwaves of Channel Islam. I heard him also for quite a few years, and I must tell you, I was trying to imagine what he looked like. It was only through the barakah of the MJ group that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me the tawfiq and the privilege to make ziyarat of this very, very important personality. He is doing tremendous work in Zimbabwe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept his khidmat. Without much ado, you have heard me many times before, I'll call our Mufti Sahab to now share with us a few thoughts. Mufti Sahab, platform is yours.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه، وبعد. اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع، ومن عين لا تدمع، ومن قلب لا يخشع، ومن بطن لا يشبع، ومن دعاء لا يسمع، وبعد. Honorable العلماء and beloved brothers in Islam, Alhamdulillah, this day being a day of Jumu'ah, the Friday, is a very blessed day, the most blessed day from amongst the days of the week. So we should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having granted us this day. In it, there is an hour in which if we make a dua, the dua will be accepted. Exactly what or which hour that hour is, we cannot confirm. But we should engage in dua throughout the day. We should engage in durood sharif throughout the day. We should feel that it is a blessed day and we should try our best to achieve something through this day. I begin with making a dua to the newlyweds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them barakah in their marriage.
Ameen.
May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them goodness.
Ameen.
And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant them a pious offspring and bring together the two families in happiness. Ameen. To be very open and frank with you, I would like to discuss a few aspects regarding nikah and a few aspects from what I have learned from the goings on around us nowadays. The difficulties we face and the good points obviously that we do have. We all know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made nikah very, very easy. We saw how many minutes it took here and how simple it is. There are many reasons for this, but one of the reasons is that man should not have an excuse to commit haram. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made something compulsory, He has made it easy for us to fulfill it as well. It is not difficult. But it is man and shaitan who comes to man that makes him feel that this is too difficult, I'm not ready to take the responsibility, it's going to be too expensive, what's going to happen in the walima, how many people am I going to call? Do you know that during the lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there were some occasions when himself, in the walima, he told everyone, bring whatever you can to eat, and they all came, they brought whatever there was, he put all the food together and they ate together, subhanallah. This is how simple the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was. Today, we would never be able to ever do that, to say, look, bring your food and come. People would probably look at us, you know, very funny and say, why did this person even get married? But remember one thing, the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if we cannot afford something, don't be shy to fulfill even that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has fulfilled. According to one narration, it is a narration that some might question, but it is a narration that I'm going to mention. To revive one sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with sincerity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will achieve the reward of 100 martyrs in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so illustrious, so simple, so straightforward. So we are left with no excuse to commit zina and haram. Sometimes what happens unfortunately around us, we tend to encourage people to delay the nikah. We say, look, get engaged now and you can marry after 2 years. Well, what's the point? Get engaged, the engagement is only in fact, the term engagement, if we hunt in the sharia, the way it's happening today is not in the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have this party and that party, you are satisfied, fulfill the nikah. Perform the nikah. Maybe if you would like to keep the rukhsati a little bit later on, and I'm sure you know what I'm speaking about, that is a better option than to delay the nikah and to unnecessarily put yourself in a position where you may just be earning the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by a phone call or a visit or so on and so forth. Unfortunately nowadays, the families will get together and afford those who are not even married, they are just engaged, afford them a holiday in Mauritius and they will, both parties will come to the airport to go and bid them farewell as though they are encouraging and giving a green license to commit zina. And who is going to commit zina? Those who are already confirmed to be married. A'udhu billah. Look at how shaitan comes. He wants us to sow a seed of cactus and then we expect apples. It is impossible. If you sow a seed of cactus, you will be pricked with the thorns that are coming very soon. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to sow the correct seed. You want goodness, let goodness prevail from day one. So that is one difficulty we are facing nowadays. The nikah, we are delaying them unnecessarily. Sometimes we feel, oh, we want to have a big walima, so I can't afford it yet, so let me wait and pile up, you know, the money. Or
collect as much as I can. No, that is against the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What an insult it is to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam if we are going to choose methods besides his method to get married and to come together. What type of children do we expect? What blessings do we expect in the marriage? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us simplicity.
Amen.
Then the other difficulty which we are facing in society today is when it comes to the nikah itself, we tend to disregard the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day that we are meant to be happy. We please everyone but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everyone is happy, shaitan is the happiest. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the angriest, if I can put it as bluntly as that. The reason is the planning of the walima itself at times is totally against the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Remember, and I'm not mincing my words here, to have music in your functions is totally forbidden. Not only planting the seeds of a cactus, that would be, but it would be planting a nuclear weapon in your home and waiting for it to tick to the day it's going to explode. What will happen? Why should we have music in a religious gathering? And we know it is haram whether the gathering is religious or not. But it is more haram and more forbidden the day a great ibadah is being fulfilled. For someone to play music in the masjid, we will probably beat him up. But for someone to play music in his car, we might go to him and say, brother, this is haram. There is a difference. One is a blessed occasion, a blessed place. The sin is greater, but they are both sins. So remember one thing, let us abstain from this, on this occasion of happiness. Look at the day of Eid, and look at the day of Nikah. Whenever there is a day of happiness, Allah has prescribed an extra ibadah. Didn't we have another khutbah today? We are going to have a khutbah of Jumu'ah. The khutbah of Jumu'ah does not suffice for that. It is a separate khutbah. It is something, it is an act of worship. Something over and above what happens on a daily basis. Look at the day of Eid. There are 6 salawat. So Allah is telling you it's a happy occasion. Make me happy by engaging in one extra ibadah also on this day.
Wow, wow, wow.
This is the message being given to us. And at the same time, what we are doing, unfortunately, we are turning away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we tend to please shaitan on that day. When it comes to our women folk and sometimes ourselves, the dressing we have chosen for that day or the dressing our own women have chosen for that day pleases none other than shaitan. What do we expect after that? Do we expect happiness? Do we expect bliss in our marriages? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us happiness. And may He grant us the ability to turn to Him today and here and now. Remember one thing, it is never too late to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why we remind one another. I need reminders, you need reminders, everyone needs reminders. If you are a mu'min, the Quran says, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَى تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And remind, for definitely the reminding assists and helps those who truly believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This reminder is for myself as well as yourself. So the second difficulty is, The problem that we face in our societies, that we do not please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the days we are supposed to be pleased ourselves. We are meant to be pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even more. The first aspect I spoke about is music, totally haram. The second is the way we dress on this day. Let us try and guide the sisters and let us try and guide those who fall under our authority, the women who fall under our authority. Let us try and guide them to say, look, this day of happiness, dress appropriately, cover everything you are supposed to be covering. For the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, imagine if He is happy on this day, wallahi, what do you want in that marriage? You are not going to have anything but the blessings and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, when it comes to the gatherings that we gather, whether it is in the home prior to the marriage, or whether it is just after, or whether it is the walima itself, or any other dawahs that we might be having, let us ensure that we have totally separate facilities for males and females. For males and females, in order to get the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is His requirement, and that requirement is there on every day. Every day, that is the requirement. But the day of nikah, it is a greater requirement, as I said. Because when we are coming into the masjid, we need to ensure that it is the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so do, we do not do anything to earn the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It will be more sinful to go to the haram in Makkah and commit a sin than to commit a sin here in South Africa, though they are both sins and we need to abstain from both of them. So I have not minced my words here. We need separate facilities, and it is not impossible. Even if we have a large wedding, remember one thing, to have a walima must be according to the your capacity, capability, your pocket. It is against the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam to go out and get debts and say, you know, my son is getting married or I am getting married, so I need to borrow money in order to fulfill this and that. No, that is against the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. For your information, to go out and get unnecessary credits, meaning to go and get money from people unnecessarily, is totally against the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He did not used to read Salatul Janazah on those who used to have debts. He used to ask, does this person have a debt? If he was told yes, he says, Sallu ala sahibikum, and he would walk away. Make Salatul Janazah on him and he would walk away. The Sahaba would feel so hurt at times, they would say, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, I am the one who is going to fulfill this debt, I take it on me. So now he would read Salatul Janazah. This is how serious it is. Today, for any small thing we want to take money, etc., etc. And the occasion of nikah, we should make sure. Let us have our nikah as simple as possible. Whether it's big or small, if it is within the framework of the Sharia and we have stayed away from that which is haram, we are allowed to have it big. And we are allowed to have it small, depending on our capacity and capability. But the criteria is, we need to ask ourselves, is it in conformity to the Sharia that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed? If it is, we will be inshallah trying to earn the barakah, and the barakah will descend from the skies. Bi-ithnillahi azza wa jal. And we need to understand one more point. When it comes to photography, whether it is a little camera or whether it is a video camera, whatever sort of photography it is, totally unacceptable in the Sharia. Let us not be confused by the viewpoints that are going around in the world today. It is something that we must understand. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned something, and remember one thing, if the ulama, and as far as I know, our akabirin are not divided on this. But if the ulama of the world are divided on an issue, remember one thing, to abstain from it is far better, because it becomes a point where there is a difference of opinion. Someone is telling you this food is halal and others are saying it's haram. What are you going to do? If you want to protect yourself, stay away from that and go to something that everyone is going to say, this is okay and this is permissible. So this is something we need to understand regarding the Sharia. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us in hadith of Nu'man ibn Bashir, radiallahu anhu, إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ بَيِّنْ وَإِنَّ الْحَرَامَ بَيِّنْ. Halal is very clear and manifest. Everyone knows this is allowed and this is halal. Haram is also very clear and manifest. Everyone knows this is haram. وَبَيْنَهُمَا أُمُورٌ مُشْتَبِهَاتٌ لَا يَعْلَمُهُنَّ كَثِيرٌ مِّنَ النَّاسِ. In between, there is a gray area that people, remember, in the eyes of Allah, it's one of the two. But as human beings, sometimes we are not so sure, is this halal or haram? The hadith says very clearly, if you fall into it, فَمَنْ وَقَعَ فِي الشُّبُهَاتِ وَقَعَ فِي الْحَرَامِ. Whoever falls into this area, they have fallen into haram. You are not sure, is this halal or haram? So you are taking a risk. Risking what? Risking your iman and your deen. Can you afford that today? Can we afford it today? This is one of the reasons why the Muslim Ummah is seen to be failing. We are not bothered. To be honest, we do what we want to do. And we will find gunjais, that is the word. We will find permissibility from anyone. We go to one mufti, you know, is this permissible? And he will say no. We will not stop. We will not sleep. We will go to the other one and the third one and the fourth one until we have crossed the continents. And we go to someone who says it's permissible. Now we say, yes, now I can sleep. Because I found the permissibility. Is that what deen is all about? Is deen going around and finding permissibilities from everywhere? If that is the case, you will find people who will tell you that those things which are clearly haram, people might say that it's halal. Does that make it halal? Wallahi, it doesn't. So iman is in the heart. And this is why at the end of the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, listen, there is a piece of flesh in the body. Ala wa inna fil jasadi lamubgha. There is a piece of flesh in the body. If that piece is going to be pure and clean, the entire body will be pure and clean. And if that piece is going to be contaminated, it reminds me of the, you know, the bird flu and the mad cow disease. What do they do to the cows? They've got to slaughter all of them because there is contamination. The same applies to your heart. If it is contaminated, your whole body, your a'mal, your iman, your deen, everything becomes contaminated and everything will be moving in the wrong direction. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us strong. So remember this. Whenever we have a function, whether it is a religious function or just a social function, ensure that we have earned the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And wallahi, if we do it with sincerity, if Allah is to take us away at that moment, inshallah, we will have a green light straight through to Jannah. Because we have done it only to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have done it only to earn the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is another point I'd like to mention here. If sometimes we have committed a sin, remember one thing, don't justify it. If we try to justify it, it becomes a bid'ah and we will never be able to rectify ourselves because we will be arguing it's right what I'm doing. But if there is a sin being committed, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all from sin. We all are involved in sin, but the levels of sin are different. Sometimes we might say a word or two which is sinful. And sometimes people might be engaged in kaba'ir of dhunub, which are sins like zina and drinking of alcohol, etc. May Allah protect us from both types of sin. But if a sin is being committed, never justify it. Because the minute we justify it, that will result in the failure and downfall, not only of ourselves, but even those around us. Because we will create problems, we will create difficulties. Why? Just to fulfill a little desire we have in our heart. Something we want, and we say, look, this is allowed, and this is permissible. Why? Because so and so said it's allowed. Yeah. What is allowed and not allowed is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permits that is allowed. And what Allah has made prohibited is prohibited. It will remain that way until Qiyamah. No one will be able to change it. So rather put more clamps on your life and enjoy this life and get the fruits of the Akhirah than to try and take out the clamps and you might just be swinging straight through to the shaitan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save me as well. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save everyone who is here. So these occasions of happiness are occasions where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing us. He wants to see, you are happy this day, what do you do? Are you going to ensure that I am also happy as your creator, the one who gave you life, the one who blew into you the ruh that you have, and the one who is going to take that ruh away? Are you not ashamed of yourself if you are going to try and disregard the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a day like this? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who understand the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are all weak. The sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is so vast. We might have 10 issues, 15 issues in our lives from amongst the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah grant us the ability to increase that. If we have 10, we should go to 15. 15, 20. I was taught by one of my sheikhs. He says, if every year you bring into your life one major sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then inshallah in 20 years, how many will you bring? 20. In 30 years, how many will you bring? 30. And sometimes we can even be stronger to bring in more of the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us strong. May He make us steadfast. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us truly from amongst those who are always concerned about pleasing Him. Don't worry about people. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَنْ أَرْضَ النَّاسَ بِسَخَطِ اللَّهِ سَخِطَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ وَأَسْخَطَ عَنْهُ النَّاسِ. Whosoever pleases the people and in the process earns the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah becomes angry with that person and very soon the people will also hate that person. If not in the dunya, in the akhirah. إِذْ تَبَرَّأَ الَّذِينَ اتُّبِعُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوا. We all know the Qur'an. And we all know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says on the day of Qiyamah there will be groups of people who will be fighting with one another. Ya Allah, this person led me astray. Ya Allah, that person led me astray. Ya Allah, I was doing wrong and this person didn't tell me anything. So we don't want to have friends of that nature. We don't want to be bothered about people who will not be able to help us on the day of Qiyamah. We don't want to have, meaning we don't want to be drowning in the lives of other people and in our own lives to the degree that we earn the wrath and anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Always be concerned of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The same hadith continues to say, whosoever pleases Allah, and I will end on this note, whosoever pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the process, the whole world becomes angry with them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with that person, and very soon, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ensure that even the people will be pleased. The minimum is in the akhirah. Sometimes in the dunya, people might not be pleased with you until you die. But then in the akhirah, because your whole life was dedicated to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no matter what people said, you will find that in the akhirah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make them understand that this person that we have here, this person has been earning my pleasure. Everyone will be pleased and they will understand this particular issue. And we must also understand, and in the, on the occasion of nikah, there will be people who will come to us and say, no, no, no. Why is it that you are having this function like this? When we want it to be Islamic, they will say, no, you can, come on. This camera here is allowed, or music, a little bit of it is allowed. Nowadays, there are people who come, they will bring you cassettes, and they will tell you, Mufti Sahib, is this allowed? A'udhu Billah. How far do we want, what do we want to justify? We'd rather close the whole issue and put it on one side, rather than trying to bring it, to please what? To please whom? You know, to achieve what? We need to understand this. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has decreed, let us purify and cleanse ourselves. You know, we need to get to a level that sometimes even the permissible things, sometimes even the permissible things, we need to start staying away from a few, because we must protect ourselves from that thing which is haram. If something is permissible and we are fearing that by doing this, if we might later on be engaged in something haram, it's better to abstain from that. That is another level of tasawwuf. To abstain from halal, fearing that which is haram. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to understand what is being said. So, people might come to you and say, no, you can have this, you can have that. Oh no, it's fine, you know, the boy and the girl, they engage, but they can meet, never mind, you can send them off, you know, to eat at the restaurant or this. What is this? People will come to you and tell you, and when you tell them, I want to do it Islamically, they say, no, this is also Islam. That is a test. A test from Allah and a fitna from shaitan at the same time. Because shaitan knows, and this is something very important, shaitan knows that this person has engaged in the obedience of Allah. How can I spoil it? How can I spoil it? And this is why I remember Mufti Mahmud rahimahullah, when one person complained to him about concentration in salah, he said something very interesting. He said that, firstly, you must thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you got to the level where you can, you are actually reading salah. You are right here. That is why shaitan came to you. A person who reads salah without wudu intentionally, may Allah protect us, he will concentrate 100% in salah, because shaitan doesn't come to him. Shaitan already got hold of it. But it is the person whose salah is correct, his wudu is correct. He came to salah, shaitan tried and tried everything but didn't get him. Now the last straw is to take concentration away. So you must thank Allah that up to that level you have got. Now work on that concentration. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us concentration in salah, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us happiness in the dunya and the akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefit myself as well as yourself from what has been said. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad.
Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر.